tending to 0.
Oh, I have put z is tending to 0. That is wrong. Of course, z tending to infinity. That's right. Take the limit when, yeah, that's
right.
Yeah.
Classical
answer, right. Yeah, right. So let me look through that, and then if needed, we will see whether we can have some tutorial and you can come over to Ayuka on day or something like that. We will see. So I'm not going to give a midterm exam. Okay. Instead, we will just have a set of assignments, typically like 7 hours each. We will have an assignment set and one final exam. Okay, so should I begin? One more. Yeah. Okay. So you two were independently looking for chalks. Okay. Right. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Right. Yeah.
It's always there in the PhD room.
Yeah. Okay. So I hope it comes back. Okay. So since we have not been meeting for some time, let me begin by reminding you what we have done so far. We started with an action principle for a free particle, which we took as minus m integral ds. Then we said we don't want just a free particle, but it has to be interacting with some field, which is like a particle which is in a potential in classical mechanics. And we tried a simple structure. I explained to you what are all the possibilities, and then we chose this Aj dxj, thereby introducing a 4-vector Aj into the problem. We found that this leads to an equation of motion which is of the form m dui by ds is equal to q times Fik uk, where we have defined the set of quantities. This is going to play a crucial role in what follows. Fab as dA of AB minus dB of AA. Okay, this is just to remind, get you back into track. We also found that these things are actually familiar to us, or things which are familiar from classical electrodynamics. Aj stands for the scalar potential and the vector potential, and these FABs essentially has 6 independent components since it is antisymmetric, and they can be related to the electric and the magnetic fields. Okay, this is roughly where we stopped. Except for one more feature which we describe, I pointed out to you that this equation only determines Fik and not Ai itself, and Ais are not uniquely determined by Fab. It is possible to have a set of transformations where Aj goes to Aj plus some dj of some function f, which leaves Fab invariant. Okay, so this we call gauge transformation, and that is going to play an important role as we go along. So now I want to proceed from here to various consequences of this, and then describe the dynamics of the electromagnetic field itself. This is what we are going to do today. So the first consequence is that the electric and magnetic fields are not the 3 components of a 4-vector, but they come out as components of a second rank antisymmetric tensor. But we know how second rank antisymmetric tensors transform when you make a Lorentz transformation. Therefore, using that, you can calculate how E and B transforms when we make a Lorentz transformation. So I won't bother about that. This is fairly elementary. You must have done it in electromagnetism. And the final result in that can be written like this. If you make a transformation along some direction, the parallel component of the electric field does not change, by which I mean the component of the electric field parallel to the direction in which you make the Lorentz boost. So if it is along the x-axis, then Ex prime is Ex. Similarly, the parallel component of the magnetic field does not change, perpendicular components change. So if you have some arbitrary electric field and you are making a Lorentz boost in one direction, you resolve the electric field into parallel component and perpendicular component. Parallel components go by this law, and the perpendicular component, the result is that E perpendicular prime is gamma into E perpendicular plus V cross B perpendicular. Perpendicular component, the result is that E perpendicular prime is gamma into E perpendicular plus V cross B perpendicular. Okay. And similarly, for B perpendicular prime, you get essentially the same thing with a minus sign. B perpendicular minus V cross E perpendicular. I would like to leave this as an exercise for you to verify, okay. But there are other important things which are related to it which we will consider. Now, once you know that the electric and magnetic fields are not Lorentz invariant quantities, the natural question to ask is there some combination of electric and magnetic fields which remains Lorentz invariant? Okay. So, FAB we know is not Lorentz, it transforms under Lorentz transformations in a particular way, but we want to construct a Lorentz invariant object out of FAB. There are several ways of doing this, but I would like to do this in a particular way, but I want to mention something else for you to work out. The thing which I want to mention is the following. You define a quantity F as E plus IB. So, you take the electric and magnetic fields and you construct a complex vector which is E plus IB. So, Fx is Ex plus IBx, etcetera. Okay. Now, you ask what happens to F under a Lorentz transformation. So, just to fix ideas, let us say we take the Lorentz transformations along the x-axis. So, when you take a Lorentz transformation along the x-axis, first thing you know is that Fx does not change. So, the change is only on Fy and Fz. And if you use these transformations, you find that these transformations are almost like four vectors, right, between time and space, except for all these complicated components which has to be taken. And we know that the four vector transformations are like complex rotations. So, when you do this, you will find that under a Lorentz transformation in the Tx plane, okay, Fy and Fz, Fx does not change, Fy and Fz gets rotated by a complex angle. That is obvious from this, but you should work it out. Okay. Now, suppose you consider all possible Lorentz transformations. Then you immediately realize that this is going to involve all kinds of rotations of F. So, you have a complex vector, but under Lorentz transformation that vector is just behaving as though the coordinate system is rotated. Now, what is invariant when a coordinate system is rotated? It is square of the vector. So, F square should be invariant. Now, if you take F square, that is going to be E square minus B square plus 2i E dot B. And of course, invariance of a complex quantity requires invariance of both real and imaginary parts. So, you arrive at this rather neat result that E square minus B square and E dot B should not change when you make a Lorentz transformation. Okay. Now, you can go and verify it using this. It is a little bit of work, but you can verify it and you will find that these things do not change. Now, there is a slightly simpler way of doing this, now that we have the machinery of tensors in our hand. and that I will describe to you. Here I have not proved, I have just left it like that, giving you an argument as to why it looks plausible that these two things will be invariant. You shouldn't take a complex conjugate. Okay. The reason is the following. I was expecting somebody to raise that. See, you don't take the, when you use the word norm, you mean different things. Normally, the norm of a vector is taken to be Vx square plus Vy square plus Vz square. When you rotate by an angle, it is Vx square plus Vy square plus Vz square which remain invariant. For example, think of two dimensions. Vx is some V sin theta, Vy is some V cos theta. So it is Vx square plus Vy square which will remain invariant. Okay? Now similarly, when you rotate a complex, whether this quantity is real or complex, it is its square which will pick up the sin square thetas and cos square thetas. So it is only F square evaluated as honest to God square which will remain invariant, where this E square and this B square of course is the Ex square plus Ey square plus Ez square. It is the norm. I could have put an absolute value scale here. But it is not that you take F and F star, okay? You shouldn't do that. If you do that, you will not even get the second term, right? No, you will not produce even that. You will produce E square plus B square and you will miss the second term, okay? So, but if you think of them in component notation, it is fairly obvious that you have Fx, Fy, Fz, which is Ex plus Iby, Ey plus Iby and Ez plus Ibz. Now when you are rotating, the sin thetas and cos thetas go and multiply them in such a way, it is only when you square and add them, you get the invariant. Okay, it's a good point, but this is how it happens. Okay. Now how do you get this in a slightly better form? To do that, you look at this quantity FAB and ask what kind of scalars you can obtain out of it. Okay, you are given this. And if I can obtain a scalar out of it, I am through. Now, one obvious scalar you can get is this quantity FAB, FAB, where you sum over all the ABs. Okay? So, if you work this out, first of all, you see what is the structure. It is going to have, suppose A is 0 and B is any one of the spatial indices. So, I have a 0 alpha and a 0 alpha summed over alpha. Now, we know that F0 alpha is just the electric field. When you go to this, you are rising 3 of the indices, space indices, so it will flip a sign. So it will have some minus 2 e square. So if you work it out, this will actually turn out to be 2 times b square minus e square. Okay? And similarly, there is one more invariant which you can construct. That is given by epsilon ABCD. FAB, FAB and FCD. So if you work this out, this will turn out to be proportional to E dot B. I think it is a minus 8 or whatever. Yeah, minus 8 times this. Okay. I don't remember thing, but that will essentially be E dot B. That also you can work this. Yeah, I thought it was in the assignment. Yeah, so you would have done that. So this, and you can stare at it and see whether you can construct any more Lorentz invariant quantities. And you will find that there isn't anything, which is based only on electric and magnetic field, that is based on FAB. So these are the only two possibilities, which is what you have. Actually, there is a very cute proof that you cannot have another invariant which is quadratic in electric and magnetic field. That is easy to show. The way you argue is that we know that E square minus B square and E dot B are invariant. Suppose there is one more quadratic invariant, then you have 3 quadratic invariants using which you can eliminate one of them and express, let us say, E square in terms of the 3 invariants. But we know E square is not invariant because E transforms like this. Therefore, there cannot be another third quadratic invariant. There can only be 2 of them. Okay? So that is what you have. So this is the first result which I want you to obtain based on what we have been doing in the last lecture. The second thing has to do with the definition of FAB in terms of this vector potential which we have got here. Now in three-dimensional notation, that gives you magnetic field B as curl of A, which are the purely special parts of that equation, and then you have an equation which tells you the electric field as minus gradient of phi minus dA by dt. Okay. Now, from these two alone, you can get two of the Maxwell's equations, because from this you know that divergence of B is equal to 0. And from this, if you take a curl, you get curl of E on the left hand side, curl of a gradient is 0, and you get minus d by dt of curl of A, that is magnetic field. So, this is minus dB by dt. So, I just, since you look a little unfamiliar, I want to spend some time on it. I thought this must have been done in some electrodynamics class, but maybe not in this form. The idea is that once you have introduced the vector and scalar potential, two of the Maxwell's equations become vacuous in the sense that they are identically satisfied. Another way of thinking about this is that if you take Maxwell's equations, even though we have always been taught divergence of B equals 0, divergence of E is equal to some rho by epsilon naught. That is a completely wrong way of looking at Maxwell's equation. Maxwell's equation should be separated out into those which have a source term on the right hand side and those which does not have a source term. Okay. So, it is not divergence of E and divergence of B which should be paired, which is the way textbooks would write it, but you should pair divergence of B with this curl of E equation. The point being, these two equations are completely independent of what is the charge and what is the current which is living in the space time. These are always true, irrespective of what charge you put, what current you put. The other two equations depends on charges and currents. Therefore, you can take the point of view that out of four Maxwell's equation, take two, I want to solve them once and for all and keep them somewhere, and the other two I will solve when somebody tells me what is the charge and the current is. Okay. So, I can reverse the implied sign and say that these are the solutions to these two equations. The way you do that is divergence of B is equal to 0, therefore, we know that B is curl of A for some A. You go and plug that into this, right, and then take away the curls except for integration constants, etcetera, and E that should be gradient of something. So, it is minus del phi minus dA by dt. Okay. Now, this is identical to this. They have exactly the same information content. That would mean that from this I should be able to get two of the Maxwell's equations, which is indeed true. The way you do that is the following. You consider the following quantity, let us say dA of, let us say epsilon ABCD FCD. Consider this quantity. So, I take FCD, then I have put a CD contraction on that, there is an AB and I am contracting on it. Okay. Now, this is equal to dA epsilon ABCD. Now, look at this FCD, this has a DC of AD minus something else, but this is anti-symmetric in C and D. Therefore, that minus something else is going to contribute exactly the same thing, right, because they are contracted out. So, I just have to put a factor 2 times DC of AD. Okay. This I claim is identically equal to 0. Can you tell me why? Exactly. These are symmetric and this is anti-symmetric. So, you already have one equation that this combination is equal to 0. If you work it out, you will find that is equivalent to these two equations. Okay. It is a very nice way of writing that equation. And in fact, people try to make it even more beautiful. This quantity is called dual of F, and differential geometers write this as star F. I just put a star here. So, star F's AB component is obtained by taking F's CD component and doing this. Okay. That is just a notation, and it is in differential geometry, it is quite useful. They would not even put the components. Okay. So, F is for them the field tensor, and star F is the dual to the field tensor. So, what it tells you is that the dual to the field tensor, if you take a divergence, it gives you 0. Okay. So, that Maxwell's equation can also be obtained by the four dimensional notation. Fine. The last bit which I want to do has to do with this action itself. So, let me come back here. I want to rewrite this action in a slightly different way with the future applications in mind. Now, this is what the action would be if I have just one charge particle with a mass m and charge q. And the notation here is extremely condensed. This actually stands for dxj by ds times ds, and the aj depends on x. It has to be evaluated on the trajectory of the charge particle, because remember that when we varied xj, we picked up a term from this a, because a depends on the charge particle, the trajectory of the charge particle. Okay. Now, what happens if I have a whole set of charge particles? Then what I would do is to change that term to some summation over a, okay, a is fine. Or let me use a capital A. We are fast running out of alphabets. So, QA, which is a charge on the eighth particle, integral AJ DXJ, with the understanding that this has a subscript A and this AJ is evaluated on that. So, if they have two charge particles, Q1 times this minus Q2 times, etcetera. So, there is a whole bunch of charge particles. This can be written in the form of a density, of charge density, by writing this as minus integral aj times rho dxj d3x. So, let me explain what this means. What we have done is to introduce a quantity rho, which is a function of time and space, by the definition summation over a qa Dirac delta function of x minus xa of t. I need you to understand what this means. First, let us just do some maths without worrying about what it means. Suppose I go and substitute it here, then I get a summation over a, then I have a qa, then I have a Dirac delta function of x on xa. When I integrate over d3x on the Dirac delta function, I keep getting every point at which the charge is sitting. So, that is completely equal to this. So, this equality sign I have proved. Now, what remains to be done is, what does this mean? This I claim is a physically justifiable description of charge density. How does that happen? So, in order to do that, let us consider a space-time diagram. This is space and this is time. Okay. Now, suppose there is a bunch of charge particles in this space-time. So, each charge particle will have a world line. This is one charge particle, this is another, this is another. This is Q1, this is Q2, this is Q3, etcetera. Now, at any given time t, I want to know what is the charge density on this space. So, at a given time t, I am looking at it. What I know is that in all these places, there is no charge. So, the charge density is 0 at all places except those which are occupied by the charge particle. Therefore, you need a Dirac delta function, which tells you that unless the charge is located at that point x, in other words, unless the trajectory of the charge particle intersects the point I am interested in, it is 0. At that point, of course, it will be infinite because we are taking a point charge, but you can smear it over a small volume. So, So this exactly describes for you the charge density in space. Therefore, this times d3x tells you the amount of charge which is present in a small volume d3x. So that is what you have done here.
Yeah, the integral means there are two integrals.
That's correct. That is correct. Now that is very nice, and you will see that it will become nicer in a minute. So let me do that, and I will explain back what the integrals imply. So this I am going to now write as integral aj rho. See, there is a d3x, but one would love to have a dt. So multiply and divide by dt. So you get dxj by dt times a dt d3x, which becomes a d4x. Okay. This quantity will be called ji, which is called a current four vector. Yes, the way our notations go, it is jj. Okay. Okay. So, how do I know this is a four vector? I know there are various ways of showing it. The easiest is the following. We know that this whole quantity is a scalar. D4x is a scalar, this is a scalar, so this better be a scalar. Okay. I mean, scalar meaning it is a proper Lorentz transformation, so it is a 4 vector. Okay. This product is a scalar, so this is a 4 vector. So what is the definition? The ja is defined to be rho dxa by dt for each of the charged particles. So this is, if you look at the components, this is just rho and a rho times v. Don't make the mistake of thinking ja is rho times dxa by ds. This 4 vector is not obtained by multiplying rho by the 4 velocity ua. Okay. It is the three-dimensional density as defined here multiplied by the dxa by dt. Lorentz transformations are taken care of because there is a dt here and a rho here. Neither of them are independently Lorentz invariant, but that combination will take care of it. Okay. So these are the components of that. This is what would have been normally called the current vector. So you find that the rho and j, the usual three-dimensional j, which we are familiar with from electrodynamics, form the components of a 4 vector. This is another non-trivial 4 vector which we have found. That's correct, because this is a density defined at a given time t, okay, on space. So that is your spatial notation. Okay. So this allows you to write this action in a very nice four-dimensional form as ai ji times d4x. Okay. If you write it like that, then it is easier to determine the connection between gauge invariance and charge conservation, which I want to spend a moment on. So if I write the interacting part of the action by that, so the A, the interaction between electromagnetic field and the current, this is going to be now written as integral, let us say AK JK, both are 4 vectors, times D4X. Okay. Now I want to know what happens to this under a gauge transformation. So if I do a gauge transformation, this is going to pick up the original term A interaction as it is. Then I am going to get an additional term which is minus integral. This AK will pick up a DK of some function F times JK D4X. Let's make sure you understand that. The gauge transformations involve changing AK to AK minus or AK plus DK of F. In my notation, I take AK plus DK of F. So that gives you a minus DK of F JK term. Okay. What does this mean? This term I can write as decay of fjk minus f decay of jk. Correct? Just integration by parts. I take a jk out, so this whole thing minus whatever I have left with, that is f decay jk. Clear? Okay. Now when I plug it in, I have a decay of some quantity d4x integral. Now this integral will give me a surface term. This is just Gauss theorem, because this is divergence of some quantity integrated over a volume. So this is the surface contribution of that quantity. Well, I can choose it to go to 0, that is the idea, because the Gauss transformation is in my hand. So I am going to choose f such that it actually vanishes on the surface. Therefore, this term will vanish, this is not going to contribute, and you are left with this. So I am choosing an f such that on the surface of a given volume it is vanishes, but inside the volume it is arbitrary. But we want our action to be gauge invariant, which means that this term has to vanish. So this tells you that decay of jk should be equal to 0. Okay. So which in words it means gauge invariance implies charge conservation. Why do I say that? Because we had done this very early on when we started out, that an equation of this kind always implies a conservation law. Now we even have the explicit form for jk. We know that jk is just rho and rho v. So if I expand it out, it is d rho by dt plus divergence of rho v equals 0, which is your standard charge conservation. Alternatively, I could have integrated this over a 4 volume and could have picked up integral rho d3x as the conserved quantity. Okay. Now this is important, because all over quantum field theory you will find that the gauge symmetries implies for you some conserved charges. This is the first simple example of what you are coming across, and in electromagnetism, but the idea generalizes to much more general construct. Okay. By and large, every continuous symmetry gives you some kind of a conservation law most of the time, and this is a simple example, and it is nicer to derive it by this form. How is it defined? No. Okay. So what I have done is the following. This is our full action. So there is a minus m ds here. Then there is this term. This term I have just called A interaction. That is, this quantity I have just defined to be the action interaction. That is just for convenience of writing, so that I don't have to keep writing both the term, because that is the term which we studied here. Okay. That's just a notation. I mean, I just called this term as this. And in that term, if aj goes to aj plus dj of phi, that is how it will change under a gauge transformation. Is that clear? Okay, fine. Now let us go a bit further. I want to now start talking about writing down an action for the electromagnetic field itself. In the earlier lecture itself, I gave you an example of a rotating spindle with charge distributed in it, where I pointed out that when you switch off the magnetic field, it will start rotating. And that works only because the field should carry some amount of energy, angular momentum, etc. Another way of thinking about that is that you have a bunch of charges moving in a given external electromagnetic field. But if you want a closed system, then you want to think of the electromagnetic field also as a dynamical entity. So you want to add an action term which controls the dynamics of the field itself. Okay. Now this is going to be new to many of you, so I am going to do it slowly. So I want to first make you understand what it means to say there is an action and dynamics for a field. We all understand action for point particles, Lagrangian and action, etc. but we want to generalize as concept for a field. Electromagnetic field is what we are ultimately interested in, but it is a lot easier to work with a scalar field as a toy example, and we will anyway need it in general relativity. So, I will first do that. Okay. So, the idea here is the following. Let us make a comparison between what I would have called non-relativistic quantum non-relativistic classical mechanics and a special relativistic field theory. Okay. So, I will start by saying what is the dynamical variable. Dynamical variable in both the cases. Okay. So, let us list here, let us say Newtonian or non-relativistic point mechanics. Okay. Then we will have what I will call the special relativistic field theory. And I will just keep listing them and I will work out the maths on the other board. So, here the dynamical variable is something like Q of t. So, there is something like a position of a particle that is your dynamical variable, it depends on time. Okay. Now, if you are studying a field, you want to know how field is changing. Now, the field is dependent on both space and time, like an electric field, it will depend on space and time. A scalar field that will also depend on space and time. Okay. Now, this is anyway in the spirit of special relativity, because if some quantity depends on time in one coordinate system, it will start depending on time and space in another coordinate system. This did not happen in Newtonian theory because time was absolute. The moment time and space gets mixed, you cannot have things depending just on time. So, here it will be something like phi, which depends on both t and x. This is the first thing. So, the independent variable here was just t, here it will be t x, y, z, dependent variable was q and here it is phi. So, the second thing you want is the Lagrangian. Okay. Lagrangian here depends, as we know, on q dot and q. Let us say we are thinking of a closed system. Okay. So, here the corresponding Lagrangian should depend on, you cannot have just phi dot without the derivatives with respect to space coming in for the same reason. So, it will depend on all the dA of phi, all the four derivatives and phi. Okay. Then from Lagrangian you go to action. Action here is just integral L dt between two endpoints. So, this is t 1 and t 2. Here the action, the independent variable here was just t. So, we just integrated over here. But here the independent variables are t and x. Therefore, here the action has to be integral L, which depends on d phi and phi symbolically, times d 4 x, because it depends on t as well as on d 3 x. Okay. I mean, stop me if I am going to come to that. Okay. So, this is the way the integral has to be done. D s. Okay. We are now not talking about a particle, but we are talking about a field. So, if you take a field, the field depends on t and x, it depends on its derivatives, this itself is the dynamic system and there is no ds which you can define for a field. If it was a particle, along the trajectory of the particle there is a proper time and you can define a ds, which is what we did. But the moment you go to the field itself, there is no ds. So, that thing does not exist. So, as he asked, there is a question as to what is the region of integration. Here the region of integration is an interval in the integration variable in one dimension. Here it has to be a region in the integration in all the four variation. So, it will be a four dimensional volume element. Now, our standard, you could have chosen any V, but our standard description of field theory is based on one space like surface t is equal to t 1 another space like surface T is equal to T2, and one boundary surface at infinity. Okay. So, usually the boundary surface at infinity we will ignore, saying that everything is going to die down at infinity, but you will have two constant time slices between which you will integrate. So, that is what is going to happen here. Now, what do you do next? What you do next is to find the field equation, right? So, I will just say variation of the action. Now, if you vary this, what you will find is that delta A will have a form like integral dt, you will have dl by dq minus d by dt of dl by dq dot delta q. Then you will have one more term, which is plus integral dt d by dt of dl by dq dot delta q. Okay. Usually we ignore it by integrating it and saying delta q equals 0, but we want to know what is going to happen there. So, let me keep both the terms. All right. So, we want to know what is the corresponding thing here. So, let us work out the variation. So, I want to study the variation of this action. So, what will that be? So, delta for the action for a field will have integral d4x, and we are going to vary this quantity. So, that will be dl with respect to d phi delta phi. Actually, it is just classical mechanics with a window dressing. Okay, there is nothing more complicated than that. You just have to get used to it. Then you will have another term, which is dl with respect to d dA of phi times delta of dA of phi, which I will write straight away as dA of delta of phi. We have described it in the previous lectures, why these two things commute. Right, this is what we have. So, we do the usual thing of doing an integration by parts. So, let us see what you get. Here, what I am going to do is to write this term, the second term, as dA of dl with respect to d dA of phi delta phi minus dA of dl by d dA of phi times delta phi outside. Let us make sure we understand that. So, this is what we have. I am going to pull this dA outside. So, that gives me dA of this whole thing, but then I have to subtract from it what I did not want. What I did not want is the dA of this quantity multiplied by delta phi. Okay? So, those two things combine together to give me dl by d phi minus dA of dl by d dA of phi, this whole thing into delta phi, plus a term which is a total divergence. It is integral d4x dA of dl with respect to d dA of phi delta phi. Okay. So, that is the basis of field theory. Just as you did it for classical mechanics, we have done the same thing for a Lagrangian for a field. just for convenience, I will introduce some notations here. In classical mechanics, we know that this dl by dq dot is what I would have called the momentum. Okay. Now, if you compare this with this, you find that it has identical structure. The first term is the derivative of the Lagrangian with respect to the dynamical variable minus. Second term is going to have here only time derivative, but we already know that in special relativity, you will have all the derivatives appearing together. Similarly, here there was only the time derivative of the dynamical variable, but here you will have all the derivatives appearing together. Okay. So, just as dl by dq dot, we want to call it as a momentum. Now, we will have, instead of just a momentum is usually with respect to the q dot, which is the zeroth component object. Now, we will get a four component object whose zeroth component will give you the energy and the other ones will give you corresponding terms. So, this quantity here, I will call it pi superscript a. Okay. Then the notation simplifies. Okay. So, this is what you have here. Here you will have delta a equal to integral d 4 x dl with respect to you get dl by d phi minus dA of pi a with that notation there, that is the first term times delta phi. Then you get plus integral over d 4 x this term, which is dA, dl by this is again going to give me a pi a delta phi. Okay. This is what you get in the corresponding field theoretic context. Now, what do I do with this? Well, we play the usual game. We first consider variations in which the boundary term will vanish, because here you would have said that this boundary term has to vanish. So, what is the corresponding statement there? In order to obtain the corresponding statement, let us consider what is the kind of boundary term it generates. So, the boundary term is going to be in this field theoretic context is going to come from integrating this. So, this is over some 4 volume V. So, you are going to get an integral over a 3 dimensional volume, which is at the boundary of that 4 dimensional volume. The usual notation for that is partial V in mathematics, time the normal to that N A dotted with the vector which you have. The vector you have is pi A delta phi. As again make sure we understand this, this dl by d dA phi is what we have called pi a, there is a delta phi term there and that together is a vector, it is the divergence of that vector which is integrated over a volume, which has to be the vector dotted with the normal to the surface. So, this is the vector dotted with the normal to the surface time delta phi. Now, what is the kind of delta we want to study? I told you that the things at infinity does not matter. So, we are only going to study so 2 t is equal to t 1 and t is equal to t 2. So, the contribution which we are going to get is actually from integral over all space d 3 x. In this notation it could have been any 3 dimension, but now I am saying it is actually d 3 x. N a is 1 in the zeroth component times pi naught, because only the zeroth component contributes delta. So, at the boundary at t is equal to t 1 and t is equal to t 2, if I keep my delta phi to be 0, phi to be constant, then I am through, in the sense that the second term will not contribute and I can get my field equation. Similarly, we also have the second kind of variation where you use the way, use the action and evaluate it along the trajectory which satisfies the classical equation. So, in this case, in the classical mechanics case, this term will vanish. In the case of a field theory, this term will vanish and only this will remain. So, the all the variation of the action would be given entirely by this term. Okay. So, the delta A can be thought of as some delta phi on that surface integrated like this, and you can read off what this is. This will be something like an energy density, I mean not quite, it is like the zeroth component of a momentum defined with respect to this dl by d phi dot. It will be essentially the time rate of change of that field. Okay. It will be related to the energy density when we define something called an energy momentum tensor, which I have not done yet. Okay. So, is this idea clear? Okay. Since I mentioned that, let me also complete that part of the job. Okay. So, you followed up to this point, right. So, this term I want to integrate. Okay. Now, first dl by dA phi, I am going to call it pi a. So, I have a pi a delta phi dA. Think of this as a divergence of a vector. The vector is delta phi times pi a and you are integrating it over a volume. So, Gauss theorem tells you that the answer will be the surface integral, which is d 3 x of whatever is that vector, that was pi a delta phi, dotted with the normal to the surface, that is n a. Okay. Then I just choose the surface to be a constant time surface. So, n a has only the zero component and that is unity. So, you are left with pi naught delta phi. Okay, at some t is equal to t 1 and t is equal to t 2 surfaces, the normal to those surfaces n a will be just 1 0 0 0. So, this is only the zero component which will contribute and this is what you will get. We will have two surfaces. So, this is the contribution from one surface. It is just like when you are doing these kind of integrals, you are going to get dl by dq dot delta q at t is equal to t 2. Minus dl by dq dot delta q at t is equal to t 1. I am just writing down one term, but there are two surfaces, that is correct. So, you have to assume that delta phi vanishes on both those surfaces, which are the boundary conditions you impose, then you will get a Euler Lagrange equation out of this term. Okay. So, this is how you would do a field theoretic calculation. Now, the last thing I want to mention, even though we are not going to need it immediately, is the following. In classical mechanics, we also have the concept of, let us say, the Hamiltonian, or more precisely the energy function, because I am not going to treat it as a function of the momentum, which is p q dot minus L, right. Now, what is p? P was like dl by dq dot. Then I have a q dot minus L. Now, the question is how does that this generalizes to a field theory? Already you know that you cannot have things like q dots hanging around. So, the q dot at least has to become derivative of the phi, q becomes phi, so derivative of the phi. Similarly, this p has to become like this pi, right. So, you need two indices for that. So, the corresponding generalization is, this goes to a quantity which I will write as T A B, which is this P replaced by pi A, this Q dot replaced by D B of phi, then the Lagrangian goes for a right, but we need the Kronecker delta A B in order to maintain the indices. So, you can think of this just as a definition. So, this quantity is called an energy momentum tensor. Now, the reason it is called an energy momentum tensor is that if you in most of the simple cases you would consider, you will find that the 0,0 component of that will give you the energy density, and 0 alpha components will give you momentum, flux, etcetera, which we will see examples later on. So, this you can also prove that if you take dA of TAB and you put it equal to 0, this implies the field equations. That is the field equations by which I mean this is equal to 0, the Euler Lagrange equations and vice versa. Okay, that is because if I have two indices hanging around here, I cannot just subtract minus L. It is like if you think of it as matrix, you write it as minus L, but multiply it by unit matrix. Delta AB is just a unit matrix. Okay, that just to maintain the consistency on the indices. Okay, that is because you have Q dot, which we know has to generalize into dA of some phi. So one index comes there. Now this P has to be replaced by a pi A kind of an object. Now there is no need for both these things to be the same. In general, I can take one index for this and one index for this and multiply them. Of course, if you take the indices to be the same, you will get the trace of this matrix. You can do that, you mean, but this is the more general construct. The most general construct you can have is to take any one of the possible alternatives for P and multiply by a possible alternative for Q. This is dl by dq dot times q dot. Yeah, but that is because you had only one quantity to play around with.
But even in classical mechanics, if I have more variables,
yes,
summation over a P,
that's correct. But your dynamical variables and independent variables, when you count, the independent variable is always time. See, you can have several, okay. So what you are talking about is a different generalization. Instead of one field phi, suppose I have phi 1, phi 2, phi 3, phi 4, 23 fields, then I will sum over that. Okay, that is a different general. I haven't even studied that. In fact, we will need it. When we start doing electrodynamics, we are not going to fool around with one field phi, but we will have a 4-vector AI, which can be thought of as 4 functions of space and time. So for each component, I will have to sum over them. But even then, you don't escape because the independent variable is only t. So there are only time derivatives floating around. This comes about only because spatial derivatives come into play. So you take the time derivative here, multiply it by a spatial derivative term here, and vice versa. So that gives you different possibilities. Okay? Is that part clear? Okay. So this energy momentum tensor will play a very crucial role in general relativity, but there we will derive it in a self-consistent way there, then and there. So I don't have to have this backed up in special relativity, but I just thought I will mention it to you. So this is what field theory does, and this is the main difference between these two, and I also explained to you what the boundary conditions are. Now our next job is to write down the correct field theoretic equations for the case of electromagnetism. That is what we are going to do next. Okay, so let us get back to electromagnetism. So we have so far obtained the following pieces of the action, which is A minus M integral ds, which hereafter is not going to play a crucial role. Then I have a minus integral AK JK d4x. I will write it in this form rather than as minus Q dxi. This is what we have got so far, and I want to claim that we have to add to this another term, which I will say the field Lagrangian or field action. Okay, this goes by the same logic that if you have only this much, then the AK's dynamics is not determined. So I want to write this field action as something like this action for the field, which I will put an F here, which is proportional to integral over d4x of some Lagrangian L. Now, the question is, what can this Lagrangian depend on? So, the first thing we know is that if you go to classical mechanics and take that as a sort of standard prototype, the Lagrangian is quadratic in the kinetic, the first derivatives of the dynamical variable, right. So, here one would have thought this Lagrangian should be quadratic in the first derivatives of AI. Okay. Now, is this a requirement? Can't I have something more generic? In principle, yes. However, it turns out that experimentally in electromagnetism, it obeys the electromagnetic theory obeys the principle of superposition. What it means is, if I have a particular kind of charge and current distribution and you find the electromagnetic field, then you have some other charge distribution and current distribution which produces a different electromagnetic field, and if both were simultaneously present, you just linearly add the electric and magnetic field. This means your field equations has to be linear, and all field equations has to be second order in time. If this has to be satisfied, then this can only be quadratic. This is what we will try to do. So, this can depend on some dj of a k in a quadratic fashion. Okay. So, it is going to depend on this quantity. What is more, we want the entire theory to be gauge invariant, because we have already seen that you can in no way determine a j by itself, you can only determine f. So, you want dynamical equations only to determine f, not to determine a j. So, it has to be built not out of these derivatives, but it better be built out of a gauge invariant object, which is your f a b. Okay. So, you want this Lagrangian to be a quadratic function of f a b. Right. Why is that? No, you will get the same equation, but if you get an equation which actually determines a j, then your gauge invariance is gone. Okay. So, we have made two assumptions in determining the form of the Lagrangian. First assumption is that the theory obeys principle of superposition, therefore, the equations has to be linear in the field variables. Second assumption is that the theory has to be gauge invariant, which means whatever action which I am going to write down here should have only gauge invariant elements present in that. And the only gauge invariant element which involves the first derivatives of the vector potential, four vector potential, is f a b. Therefore, I am claiming it has to be a quadratic functional of f a b. Okay, fine. Now, the life is a little easier. What are the quadratic functionals of f a b? Because the Lagrangian has to be a scalar, and we have already done that, and we know only two of them are there. One is f a b, and the other is f times epsilon. The next thing I want to say is that f epsilon is not of much use. So, let me try to prove to you why. So, if you look at that object, let us look at that a little bit closely. So, I will start with epsilon a b c d f a b f c d. Okay. The question is, do we want to put that there? So, let us expand it out. So, I will first write it as epsilon a b c d f a b, and I play the same trick that on c d there is a d c of a d and another one with a flip, and that just gives me factor 2. So, this is going to be twice d c of a d. Okay. The next thing is that I can pull this through this quantity, correct, because when I pull it through, it is going to act on f a b, which will involve a c a derivatives or a c b derivatives, both of which is killed by this epsilon. Therefore, I can write this as 2 times d c of epsilon a b c d f a b times a d. This I do not care.
I do not follow
Okay, so let us see. So I take this delta C through this. These are constants, I don't care. So I can take this whole thing through and I will get that term. Then I have to subtract out of it whatever is not taken care of, which is dc of FAB. dc of FAB, let us expand it out. FAB has a dA of AB, so there is a C and an A will come, or a B and a C will come and they go away. Therefore, this is correct. Hence, this term, when I integrate over d4x, will only contribute on a surface. Okay? And we will assume that on the surface, either fields all vanish at space-like surfaces, and on time-like surfaces, we are keeping it frozen, so that there is no variation which is given. So there is no bulk variation to this term. Therefore, this is not a useful thing to put in the action. So, no, this is a divergence, right? So when I put this as a, suppose I have a term here and I do integral over this thing, it is only going to contribute on the boundary. A better way of thinking about this is that we want an action which is d4x times a quantity which can vary in the space-time volume. We don't want an action which is a pure surface term. Okay? Now, there are caveats to this. There is a whole class of quantum field theories called topological quantum field theories, where only these kind of surface terms and their brothers and sisters will contribute. But under normal circumstances, when you are doing this sort of gauge theories, you ignore these surface terms. With that philosophy, we will drop this term. Okay. Okay. What are we going to do with the action? We are going to vary this, right? When we vary this, we are going to fix something at the boundary. Suppose I have a surface term and I am going to vary it by saying that at the surface it is not changed. Then it does not contribute to your field equation. So, to the extent that it does not contribute to the field equation, you do not want to include any of them. So, this is a general philosophy in field theory, I mean mostly used and sometimes misused, where all the surface terms will be dropped. Okay. So, the only thing which is left out for this, this has to be an integral over d4x of FAB. Okay, this is all it remains. Of course, you can multiply it by a constant. Now, what constant you multiply it depends on your system of units. So, since I am following Landau, I will use that those units, and minus 1 upon 16 pi is the constant in that system of units. Okay. You could have chosen any constant that you just rescale your electric and magnetic fields appropriately and you can do this. If you are SI guys, then you have to replace every 4 pi by 1 upon epsilon naught. Okay. But we are not going to do electrodynamics at all, so it does not really matter. We will just derive Maxwell's equation and then we are going to do GR. Okay. So, this is the notation. Now, the question is why this minus sign? That can be sort of demonstrated by the same argument which I gave you in the first lecture. If you look at FAB, it is 2 times b square minus e square. So, once I have the minus sign, e square comes with a positive sign. Now, if you look at the nature of e square and b square comes from curl of A, that we do not care, but the electric field has a minus dA by dt. So, the square of the electric field involves the like a kinetic energy term dA by dt square, and we want that term to have a positive sign. Okay? Therefore, we keep a overall minus sign. So, the action now becomes this minus 1 over 16 pi integral over d4x of FAB. Okay. So, the next question is what kind of field equation does it lead to? So, for that we have to vary this action with respect to the vector potential now. We are not touching the charges. So, this term does not change, jk does not change, but we are going to vary ak. Remember, this is like the scalar field now. The field is the dynamical variable and we are just going to vary. So, again as I told you originally, if you do not think about it and you go through the algebra, it will work. If you stop and think, then you better think it through completely. Okay? So, let us look at the variation of that. So, So, you have delta of A. So, the first term does not contribute. In the second term, I get minus d4x jk delta ak. This comes from this term. Okay, so let us see, there are no other combinations is the argument. The argument is that it has to be quadratic in F. So, it should have two F's. So, you write FAB, FCD, you have four indices and you have to contract out all of them, right? You cannot contract A with B because that will give you 0, is an anti-symmetric tensor. So, you have to contract this with this or this with this. But if you contract this with the second one, that is equivalent to adding a minus sign. So, that is not independent. Therefore, when you are contracting two F's, this is the only possibility available. The only other alternative left for you is you can write down FAB, FCD and find a four index object with which it, this can be contracted. And the four index object should be something which you come up on your own. And the only such object is epsilon. So, you have an epsilon ABCD times this, but that we ruled out is a good possibility because it is just a surface term. Another way of thinking about this is the gauge invariant combinations you can obtain from vector and scalar potentials are electric and magnetic fields. Therefore, this action has to be quadratic in electric and magnetic fields, right. So, it is something like some alpha E square plus some beta B square. But it has to be Lorentz invariant. Therefore, it has to be a Lorentz invariant component of E and B. E dot B we have ruled out because E dot B is coming from this. So, you have alpha E square plus beta B square and you want it to be Lorentz invariant. We know that the only Lorentz invariant combination which we proved earlier on is E square minus B square and E square minus E square is FAB. So, there is no other possibility left. So, it is actually very nice because as I have been trying to point out right from day one, the action principles are the fastest way to either discover physics or learn physics because you need to do minimal amount of learning. Okay. And second, when you are trying to go into a new uncharted territory, action principle immediately tells you what is allowed and what is not allowed by symmetry. And the larger the symmetry is, the better, and it rules out more things. So, in special relativity, for example, we found that integral ds is the only possibility. Then when we wanted to add a field, I told you that it can be ai dxi or square root of gab dxi dxp. These are the only two possibilities. Then once you have got that and you want to add a field term, you wanted to introduce one extra principle which is gauge invariant. The moment you do that, this is the unique term which is left out. Okay. So, it is actually quite elegant. Fine. So, now we are going to vary that. So, this is the first term and now let us vary the second term. So, that is minus 1 upon 16 pi integral d4x. So, I am going to vary FAB, FAB, it is like the square of FAB. So, there are twice variation in any one of them and I will keep it as FAB on top and do delta of FAB with AB at the bottom. Okay. Now, let us see what this is. Here again bad notation. So, let me call this ij fij. All right. So, this is going to be fij, this quantity is as it is, delta of di of aj minus a dj of ai, that will again give me a factor 2. Okay. You are through with that. Okay. Now, this delta of di of aj we know can be they can be commuted. So, it is 2 fij di of delta aj. Which again can be written as 2 di of fij delta A j, the usual trick, minus 2 dI of Fij delta Aj. Let us make sure we understand what is going on. You start with that FAB, you are going to vary that. First you get a factor 2 because there are 2 terms to vary. It is like delta of x square, it is 2 times delta of the rest of the thing. So you have Fij and a delta of Fij. This Fij I kept as it is. Delta of Fij is going to have a di Aj minus dj Ai. Both of them are going to contribute the same thing because of this antisymmetry. So you put a factor 2 and keep one of them di of Aj, okay, delta of that. Then you commute this delta with di. So you get 2 Fij di of delta Aj. Then you play the usual game. You take this di all the way through. 2 di of Fij delta Aj minus whatever is the derivative of this quantity is, it is 2 times di of Fij delta Aj. Okay? So we have to now plug that into it. So we get this is equal to minus integral d4x. jk delta ak in the first term, then in the second term minus, there is a factor 2 in both these terms and there is a factor 2, so it will give me 1 over 4 pi integral d4x, okay. There are 2 terms there, so let me write down both. One is di of Fij delta Aj, this is the first term, minus di of Fij times delta Aj. Okay. Here it is nicer to make this k, so instead of j I will use k and a k here. Well, just for consistency I can put a k here and a k here, not that it matters. Okay. So now I want to collect all the coefficients of delta ak, so that will give me minus integral d4x delta ak there is a jk from here, then there is a minus and a minus which is plus and I have pulled out a minus, so there is an extra minus sign, 1 upon 4 pi di of Fik. This takes care of this term and this term, okay. Then I have a minus 1 upon 4 pi integral over d4x times di of Fik delta A. So we have successfully done one field theoretic variation of the action. So this is what you get. Now what do we do with this? Well, as I said before, there are 2 kinds of variations which we consider with any action principle, and we can do the same thing here also. The first thing which we are going to do is to look at this second term and say that this is divergence of some vector. You integrate it into a surface term. On the surface, assume for a minute delta Ak vanishes. Okay? So once you have done that, this term is not going to contribute and you get your field equation. So, the field equations you get are if from the first term is dI of Fik is equal to 4 pi times jk, right. Now, we need to know what this means. Okay. That is not too difficult. Suppose, for example, you take the zeroth component. So, if you take the zeroth component, k is equal to 0, if you put this is rho and you have put the zeroth component here. So, only alpha survives and alpha is summed over, and that quantity is just the divergence of the electric field. It is d alpha of E alpha. So, this for example will give you one of the things which you will have is divergence of the electric field is equal to 4 pi rho, or in SI units it will be rho by epsilon naught. Okay. And I will let you work out the second equation, and you will find that that is essentially going to give you the curl of B is equal to that 4 pi times j and dE by d theta. Okay. So, the two Maxwell's equations which involve charges and currents comes out very nicely out of this. So, the whole of Maxwell's equations can be written as dI of Fik is jk, dI of F star ik is equal to 0. Okay. The divergence of the Maxwell tensor is j except for constants, and the divergence of the dual of the Maxwell tensor is 0, and these together summarizes all of electrodynamics. So, this is why I said the nice way to think about electrodynamics is source free part and the source part, and the source free part is anyway solved by introducing the vector potential. Okay. So, this is what we have. Now, as an extra bonus, there is something interesting at that last term which I want to describe to you, because that is usually not done in textbooks. For example, I do not think Landau does that. So, you take this delta A, but now you look at on the classical solution, which means this Euler term vanishes. What you are left is that quantity, it is minus 1 over 4 pi integral d 4 x dI of f I k a k. Delta Ak. This I am doing more for fun, it is not needed anywhere. So, this will give you minus 1 upon 4 pi integrated on the surface, and let us assume the surface is t is equal to constant. So, let us look at it on a constant t surface. So, this is on constant t surface. This is going to give me an integral over d 3 x, only this is going to be replaced by the n I, and only the zeroth component of that is going to contribute. So, you get f 0 k delta a k, correct. This is the surface term which we want to put to 0. On the classical solution. Okay. That's correct. Okay. But I don't have to even do that. I can just look at that extra surface term in order to understand what should be kept fixed at the end point. So, this is what we have on the t is equal to constant surface. Now, you first notice that because of antisymmetry only the spatial part contributes. So, this is alpha and this is alpha. Okay. So, this is essentially proportional to integral over d 3 x of E dot delta A. Now, there are two curious things you notice here. The first thing is you have to fix delta of the vector potential on the surface. You do not have to fix the scalar potential at all. See, we started by saying our dynamical variables are A I, which means that there is a scalar potential phi and 3 ax, ay, az, 3 vector potentials. If the dynamical variable has been q1, q2, q3, q13, at the end points you fix all of them. So, normally one would have thought that all of them need to be fixed, and you find that you do not have to fix phi at all. Okay. This is very peculiar, and the question is, why does this happen? There is no other case in classical mechanics where this will happen.
Nothing.
No, there are other cases, but they are all in field theory. The reason has to do with the following. If you look at FAB, let us ask what, see, dynamical variable is something whose time derivative appears in a quadratic manner in the action, right. Now, time derivatives can come only if one of these indices is 0, it does not matter which one. So, the moment one of the indices is 0, the other index has to be space. Therefore, only the time derivative of the vector potential enters this. Time derivative of the scalar potential never enters your action. Of course, it is obvious if you think of it as E square minus B square. B does not have any time derivative, E has only the time derivative of the vector potential, right. So, phi is sort of a vague kind of a degree of freedom, and you will keep finding it all throughout. Because the theory is gauge invariant, it is possible to choose a gauge in which, for example, phi is actually 0. Okay. There is, you have one degree of freedom left. Therefore, that freedom will come and hit you in different forms in different places, and this is one example of that. Okay. So, you do not need to actually fix phi, you only have to fix the vector potential. Actually, if you think about it, you do not even have to fix the whole of vector potential. That is again important, because we said that vector potential is not even observable, right. So, how do I fix my vector potential? So, I can only fix vector potential up to a gauge transformation. Suppose I change, I think of this delta A as a pure gradient. Suppose I have done that. So, it is del of some gradient of some delta F. Then that gradient will go into one integration on d3x, which is a compact surface. So, that will not contribute at all. The other one will have a divergence of E times that quantity, and divergence of E is like, I mean, if you are doing of a free field, divergence of E is 0. Otherwise, it will give you total charge, which also you can ignore. Therefore, even A, you need to fix only with respect to the gauge transformation. That is nothing but magnetic field. So, there is a very nice picture in electromagnetism that the magnetic fields are your coordinates. They are like you. Okay. And the electric fields are like momenta, these are like E, because the whatever is varied and left here is P Q dot, right. So, whatever is left is the this. So, the coordinates in electromagnetism, which are nice gauge invariant objects, are the magnetic fields and the momenta are the electric fields. This is a nice concept to go by, and that is why you have these kind of terms coming up in the end. Okay. So, with that you already know how to freeze these. Yeah, I think I have to stop now. So, and obtain this field equation, and the field equation I have got you one of them, the other one you can work out. It also, we can verify here that it is also should be consistent overall, that we said that the jk has to be conserved. If you take a dk of this, it is dk di is identically vanishes, so jk is conserved. So, that also tells you that if you go and couple this system, suppose you only look at this term and this term, when you first study this term and this term, A is externally specified. When you study this term and this term, J is externally specified. Suppose somebody has given you a J which is not conserved. You go through this, you will get this equation, and if J is not conserved, you run into a contradiction. Okay. So, it can couple, a gauge invariant field can only couple to a source which is conserved, and that is what this tells. Let me stop there, and we will take it from here tomorrow.